Well, hello. Welcome to my humble kitchen. I'm Samantha, and I hope you're ready to make some nice Belgian waffles. You're gonna grab yourself a medium-sized bowl. I prefer a copper, but anything will work. Along with the bowl, you will need oil, an egg, a wooden spoon, butter, Belgian waffle mix, water, a ladle. Now would be a good time to preheat your iron. Let's bring you in a little closer. Now we're gonna add a cup and a half of our mix. There's one, and here's a half. That was easy enough. Here's where we add in our wet ingredients. I like to start off with our liquids, and we do the egg last, just in case we get any of the shell in. Putting in 2/3 a cup of water, and 3 tablespoons of oil. 1, 2, 3. Now we're going to crack our egg into the empty measuring cup. Like I said, this way, in case there's any shells, we can get it out nice and easy. We're gonna add that egg in. Now we're going to hand mix. Once your batter looks just about like this, you are set. We are going to take a paper towel and we're gonna fold it up a few times to make it nice and thick. Once folded, we will put a piece of butter on the corner and rub it in the iron to get it nice and greasy. You're gonna wanna be careful not to burn yourself. This is very hot. Look at that sizzle. Now we're gonna take our small ladle and put it right in the center of the iron. You're gonna wanna use 2/3 of your batter. Looks just about right. You're going to close your iron. We are gonna set a timer for 4 minutes. Here we are. Beautiful golden brown. We are going to quickly move it onto our plate. Now is your time to top your waffle off, however you may desire. I'd like to thank each and every one of you for taking time out of your day to spend this special time with me. Bon appetit.
I'm going to cook one of the best burgers you've ever had. Follow this recipe. Cooking can be hard, especially when you have to entertain for your guests. But once you learn this recipe, you won't be wondering, what should I cook?
Before anything, you want to preheat your grill to high. Have all your ingredients prepped and ready so you are not running around. Take the form burgers and sprinkle olive oil, salt, pepper, and garlic powder on them. Smother the flavors on the patty. Then throw it on the grill. Since you want more flavor, caramelize the onions by putting them on the grill with a little bit of olive oil, salt, and pepper. Then put the buns on as well with the added oil, salt, and pepper. Make sure to toast both sides. Take your butter and cover the outsides of your burger with it and make sure to get both sides. Try flipping your burger a minimum amount of times because the more you flip the patty, the less flavor it holds. Take the bun off and put your sriracha and mayo on both sides of the bun. Then put your lettuce and tomato on the bun, and you can add avocado if you please. After that, add salt and pepper to the tomato. After that, take the burgers off the grill. And then your onions after. You don't want to bite into that burger right away because all those juices will fall out that give it flavor. If you are using a leaner meat, then your burger will shape into almost a ball, but it doesn't take away from the flavor. Put that bun on top. Put a toothpick in so it doesn't fall apart. And cut it in half if you desire, and there is your perfect burger.
Now you can impress your guests, or even just fulfill the needs of your taste buds. This would be great for a summertime party, and everybody will talk about your burger making for weeks.
Beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? Would you be my neighbor? Hello, boys and girls. It's your good friend Red Froges here, and today I'm gonna teach you how to be healthy. Come on! Now the first step to being healthy is a good exercise.
Now what could I possibly mean with good exercise? Well, I'm gonna tell you.
Types of physical activity such as
sit-ups, push-ups, and planking
will help you get more physically in shape, just like good old Mr. Froges.
God, I hate kids.
Hello again, boys and girls. Let's talk about another way that we can stay healthy, by cleaning ourselves.
Now, one way we can clean ourselves, boys and girls, is by washing our hands. Now, there's a very good way that you can wash your hands, and I'm gonna show you now.
Now, first, what you wanna do is turn on the water. Good. Now, wet your hands a little bit just to get them moist. Now, get your soap and apply a little bit to your hand. That's a good amount right there, boys and girls. Next up, start rubbing your hands together, combining the water and the soap in order to make suds. Very nice, boys and girls. Just keep on scrubbing until those hands are nice and clean.
Now, a good idea, boys and girls, is while you're washing your hands, listen to a song that you like while you're washing. That way, it'll be way more fun than just standing there staring at nothing.
Chain a lot of names on song. Know that we have always been down, down. If I ever get a thank you, you, then just let me do it now. Come back in.
And once you're done, boys and girls, just dry your hands off.
Now, boys and girls, a little warning about soap. Now, while it may look very colorful and it may say it's scented fresh citrus, it might smell nice, but
it doesn't taste nice. Jesus!
I thought the health and way easy healthy is by making sure your house is nice and tidy. Let me explain.
Now let's start with this table here. So we're gonna take a pledge wipe out of the container, just like this, boys and girls. See, you have to pinch a little bit. Now that we have this pledge wipe, we're gonna put the bag down right there. And we're gonna take our pledge wipe and we're gonna start nicely wiping down the table, just like this. Everyone knows that a healthy home is always good for a healthy boy or girl. Right, boys and girls? We want to stay healthy.
Cleaning doorknobs is also important, boys and girls. A lot of people use them, so get rid of those germs.
And now that we're done with our pledge wipe, we're going to dispose of it properly in this trash can.
Very good job, boys and girls.
All right, boys and girls. I hope you enjoyed today's episode. And remember, it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. A beautiful day for a neighbor. Could you be mine? Would you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor?
Who doesn't like a nice warm cookie? I know I do, but it can be hard to make them just right.
If you want to know how to make the perfect cookies, you're in the right place because I'm going to show you how in 9 easy steps.
The first thing you need to do is read over the recipe and gather your ingredients. Here are all the ingredients you'll need to make these cookies. In a small bowl, add in your dry ingredients. 2 1/4 cup of flour, 1 teaspoon of salt, and 1 teaspoon of baking powder. Set this aside while we move on to our next step. In a large bowl, mix together your butter, sugar, and vanilla extract. Slowly incorporate your eggs. You can use a stand mixer to make this step way easier. Now that the wet mixture is situated, you want to gradually add in the flour mixture so that it is easy to combine. Don't forget your chocolate chips! If you prefer nuts, you can add those to your mixture as well. When your cookie batter is fully mixed, it's ready for the oven. Prepare your cookie sheet by lining it with parchment paper. Scoop out balls of dough and place them onto the cookie sheet about 2 inches apart. The easiest way to do this is with a spoon or an ice cream scoop. Now that they are all lined up, they're ready for the oven. Bake them at 350 degrees for about 10 minutes. If you're not sure if they're done, check that they are golden brown along the edges. Once you take them out of the oven, move them onto a cooling rack and let them cool. If you didn't want cookies before watching, I'm sure you do now. You can make these delicious cookies in under 30 minutes. Enjoy them while they last.
Hi, this is Joey, and today I'm going to show you how to fly a drone. So, a drone is a small four-winged helicopter. Mine is basic and doesn't have a camera. Some of them are fancy and even have cameras on them. Drones can also be used to deliver things, even pizza. Sometimes rescuers use a drone to search for people in emergencies. Without further ado, let's get to the steps. Step 1. Turn on your drone until it lights up. Step 2. Turn on your controller until it makes a beep noise and glows red. Step 3. If it keeps blinking on the drone, you must move up and down with controller. And then your drone will get ready to fly. Step 4. To start flying your drone, you must push this middle black dot, and your drone is now taking off. Step 5. To move up, simply use the left movable gray button. Step 6, to move down, use the left movable gray button again to go down. Step 7, for the right movable gray button, that will make the drone move forward, back, left, and right. Step 8, your drone could also tilt left and right by using the left movable gray button. Step 9. To stunt, push the stunt button where it says stunt. And you could choose whatever way you want. Forward, back, left, and right. Step 10. To land your drone, push the middle black dot, and your drone will easily go down to recover. Step 11, and your speed could go up to pace, which is 1 beep, medium, which is 2 beeps, and higher level, which is 3 beeps. Step 12, if your drone goes up to higher level, this is how fast my drone can go. Step step 13. If the battery on your drone is dying, it's going to blink its lights and give you a warning. Step 14. If your drone is dead while it's still flying, your drone will come down to try to land. But if your drone is still higher while it's still trying to come down, it's just going to fall itself. Step 15. So to completely charge your drone, it takes 2 to 2.5 hours. Thanks for watching this video. I showed you all the ins and outs of flying a drone. Hope you become an expert at flying drones like me.
Hi, and welcome to the Homemade Cooking Show. I'm your host, Maggie, and today we're making a 5-minute homemade grilled cheese. Whenever you're stuck at home, like on a rainy day, you're probably feeling some low energy while hanging around the house. A warm grilled cheese just takes a few simple ingredients to make, and you can even customize it however you choose. This is a perfect option to have something quick and easy to eat without having to resort to junk food in the pantry.
The ingredients you need will be a nonstick skillet, a spatula, a stick of butter, bread of your choice, today I'm using white bread, and a cheese of your choice, today I'm using American.
Stay tuned to learn how to make this warm, delicious sandwich.
We're going to first set a nonstick skillet on the stove over medium heat. Assemble your sandwich. Place 4 to 5 slices of cheese between 2 slices of bread. This is optional. If you want to spice up your sandwich a bit, feel free to add any other ingredients of your choosing. Here, I'm adding some fresh cherry tomatoes I had in my kitchen. You can also add ingredients like avocado, bacon, peppers, onions. The possibilities are endless. Add approximately 1 tablespoon of butter into the skillet and spread around the bottom of the skillet until melted. Once the butter is melted, place your assembled sandwich onto the skillet. Every few seconds, press down on the sandwich with your spatula so the sandwich begins to melt together. Wait 2 to 2.5 minutes, or until your sandwich is melted to your liking and the bread face down on the skillet is golden brown. Then flip. Wait another 2 to 2.5 minutes for the other side of your sandwich to cook to your liking until the bread appears identical to the first slice. Use your spatula to lift your grilled cheese out of the skillet and onto a plate. Finally, cut your sandwich in half. And you're done.
Now that you've made your homemade grilled cheese, now you can dig in. Feel free to pair your sandwich with some healthy fruit, like strawberries or some grapes. To all our viewers, I hope you're staying safe, healthy, and taking care of yourself. Easy options like this grilled cheese satisfy your appetite and keep you from having to stuff your face with chips and ice cream. Stay tuned for more easy recipes next week. Thanks for watching.
Les rêves des amoureux sont comme le bon vin. Ils donnent de la joie ou bien du chagrin. Affaibli par la faim, je suis malheureux. Pas longtemps chemin, tout ça.
Hey you! Yeah, you! Are you hungry? Do you have 12 minutes to spare? do you like the combination of the words and Kraft and mac and cheese? Well, I have some good news for you. Today I'm going to be teaching you how to make Kraft macaroni and cheese. Let's go.
First thing you're going to want to have to do is find a box of Kraft mac and cheese. So I'm out here in the wild and we're going to see if we can find one here.
I wonder if we can find... There's one right there! Finally, I can eat.
That's good. Next thing you're gonna wanna have to do is get a pot. What you're gonna wanna do is get 6 cups of water and pour it into the pot. Then you're going to want to get your pot full of water, place it on the stove, and set it off on high. You're gonna have to wait until it boils though, so I'm gonna go catch up on some reading.
Yeah, I love this book.
The water's done boiling. Let's go check on that. Then you're gonna wanna open your box, take out this packet of cheese, set that aside, and pour in the macaroni. Then you're going to want to, get one of these. No. Then you're gonna wanna get this and stir for 7 whole minutes. Now, I don't really have a timer, so I'm just gonna count aloud. 420, 419, 418, 417, 416, 415.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Wow, that was a long 7 minutes. Then you're going to get a colander, and then you're going to put it in the sink, and then pour your macaroni into the colander. Make sure you shake it around so you get all that water out, and then pour it back in. Then you're going to have to get your cheese packet and pour the cheese. Where's... Hey, need that! Alright, that was a little weird, but you're going to want to get your cheese. It should normally be in this packet. You're going to get your cheese and then just dump it into the pot. Then you're going to get a butter knife and then some butter, or I can't believe it's not butter. Either one works. And you're going to want to get 2 little dashes and just dab it in there. So. Next, you're going to want to have to get some milk. And the milk should be right here. Let's go find it. Yeah. Milk? 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 No. I'm not gonna ask any questions, but you're gonna wanna get some milk. Then you're going to get 1/4 cup and pour some milk in there. And then, once you have enough, just dump it into the mac and cheese. Then you're going to wanna just stir it and mix it all together. Just like this. You'll almost be done once when you notice that the cheese dust is starting to go away. It shouldn't be in the bowl anymore. It should just be mixing in with the macaroni and cheese. Your finished product should look something like this. Then you just want to scoop it all up, pour it into a bowl, and enjoy. Well, I hope you learned a thing or two today. And I hope you enjoy your mac and cheese. And I'll see you next time. The milk went missing again.
Hi everyone, in today's video I'll be giving you step-by-step instructions on how to make slime. Adult supervision is highly recommended if you are under the age of 6. So without further ado, let's get started.
First, get some glue. I recommend Elmer's 5-ounce white or clear glue, but any glue will work fine. Then find yourself saline solution for sensitive eyes, and any kind of shaving cream. These are the main 3 ingredients to make slime. A bowl, but not this one. Much better. A mixing spoon. Measuring spoons. A scent of your choice. And color dye. 1/3 cup of sparkles and or 1/2 cup of beads. Then gather your materials and put them on the surface you'll be using. I recommend your kitchen table or any safe and sturdy surface. Next, cover your spot with paper towels. Next, place down your bowl and take your Elmer's glue and pour the whole bottle in. Then take your shaving cream and spray for about 5 seconds all over the glue. Then, taking your choice of color, drop 10 to 15 for a light color and more for a darker color. Then take 1/2 teaspoon of the scent you want to use and pour it in and mix. Next, take 1 tablespoon of saline and pour it into the mix. Then it should start coming together like this. Then once it starts coming together, put your hands in and start kneading it. If it appears to be sticky, add more saline. And it should come out just like this. Then pour in your 1 cup of sparkles and knead it together. Then pour in your beads and mix together. And that is how you make your own personal slime at home. Also, make sure to keep it in a small, safe container. And you're done!
I hope this helped everyone out on how to make slime and you were happy with how yours turned out. Thanks for watching.
Hello and welcome back to Price's Kitchen. Today I'll be teaching you something that is very important to know how to make, and it will be good for anyone who needs something on the go and doesn't cost a lot of money. This Asian cuisine is called ramen noodles. Let's get started.
First, fill up the pot with any type of filtered H2O, a little less than halfway. Then put on this pot on the stove. Increase the water temperature to 212 Fahrenheit. After letting it boil, take the ramen out of the fine packaging and then drop it gently into the pot. Then you must wait for the noodles to get soft in texture. Then open the packet with abundance of flavor and put it into the pot of noodles. Then stir the noodles in a circular motion. Take the pot of noodles off the stove and strain the H2O into the sink. Then enjoy your freshly made ramen noodles.
Now you know how to make ramen noodles the correct way. Wasn't it fun and easy? Now it's your turn to try to follow the steps to make your very own ramen noodles.
In the world of music, knowing the needs of your instrument is a crucial part of learning to play to the best of one's ability. This can be best seen in learning the ability to change the strings on one's instrument. When strings break on an instrument or just become old and dirty, the best thing to do is replace them. This task can be tricky, and it is important to do so safely and correctly to be able to create the best sound with the instrument. Today, you'll be learning how to change an acoustic guitar string quickly and easily. The first step of the task is to assess the situation. There are 2 reasons to change a string: if a previous string breaks, or just in order to maintain a safe and sanitary instrument. This step not only includes assessing your reason for changing, but also the type of strings you may need. Today, you'll be observing me changing the low E string on my acoustic guitar. I'll be using the Ernie Ball Earthwood brand. Along with your replacement strings, you'll need a pair of pliers, wire cutters, rubbing alcohol, and a soft cleaning cloth. The second step, after observing the situation and obtaining the proper strings, is to remove the old string. To To remove the old string, lay the instrument facing upwards on a flat surface. Start at the head of the guitar by loosening the desired string's tuning peg all of the way. After this, remove the string from the hole in the tuning peg. The next step is to remove the other side of the string from the instrument. This can be done at the bridge of the guitar. For this step, you'll need a pair of pliers. Identify the respective bridge pin to the desired string, and use the pliers to remove the pin. Once the pin is removed, pull the bottom of the string out of the hole in the instrument. Inserting a new string is basically a reverse of the first couple steps. First, place the beaded end of the string into the hole at the bridge. After this end is inserted, replace the bridge pin over the end of the string. Make sure to secure the pin tightly. After this, outstretch the string over the body and neck of the guitar to the respective tuning peg at the head of the instrument, and insert it into the hole from the inner side of the instrument. When replacing strings, the first three strings are to be inserted from the left side of the tuning peg hole, and the last three strings should be inserted from the right side. Once the string is inserted, you should knot it around the hole. You only have to knot it once, but make sure you tighten it. You should leave about 3 inches of string on the end of the knot in order to safely tighten the knot. We'll cut off the excess later. After knotting the string to its tuning peg, turn the peg to tune the instrument. This can be done by hand, but a helpful purchase to speed this process up is a peg winder. The first three strings should be turning clockwise, and the final three counterclockwise. Once the string is taut, you can use an electric tuner or another instrument to finely tune the desired string frequency. Once the string is tuned, you may cut off the excess of the string with wire cutters. Once all the desired strings are replaced, it's important to sanitize your instrument. This can be best done using a soft cloth or cotton ball dipped in rubbing alcohol and gently rubbed on the desired area. This should include both the new strings as well as the frequently touched tuning pegs and pick guard. And with this important step, your guitar string replacement is complete. Though acoustic guitars come in many shapes and sizes, you can use this basic formula to replace any strings on an instrument. This skill will be important moving forward in your music career, and it's always a good idea to keep an extra set of strings in your travel bag, just in case a string needs replacement.
It's important to always take care of your instrument to prevent damage and make it sound as beautiful as it can.